Here we are, Badlands Radio, Wednesday night. The sun has set. You know, we had helicopters cruising over, or a helicopter cruising over earlier, probably about 2 hours ago. Real slow, just kind of hovering over the studio. And whenever I walked out with the camera, then it skedaddled. Don't know what it means, but it was there. That's a video of it. We'll put that up on the website so you guys can take a look at that. You know, we always get some kind of strange flyby around here. All right, tonight, my guest, John Thomas, we're going to be talking about the Cyril Effect. It's an amazing true story. In 1946, a young boy of 14 built a device that lost its gravity and flew up and hit the ceiling of the room which he assembled it. This is done by a boy who, at the age of 12, could neither read, he couldn't write, and he was given this new technology in the form of dreams, which he received from the age of 4.5 to the age of 10. And me and David Sarita had talked about this before on the air. Fascinating story. So tonight, John Thomas is here with me to talk about the Cyril Effect. John, welcome to the program.
Oh, thank you.
It's great to have you on. I know that I've talked a lot with my producer Celine about this particular story. Why don't we outline it like this? Start off by telling me how you met John.
Sure. A mutual friend of ours was Bill and Rhoda Sherwood, and Bill and Rhoda wrote a newsletter that John Cyril was putting out, and they put together the newsletter and mailed it out to subscribers, and we were quite close. Actually, they visited John in England and saw a craft that he was building called Demo One.
Yes.
Now, their group was actually a UFO study group, and that I belonged to, and which UFOs were always quite frustrating for me because, you know, everybody says they saw them and they did fantastic things, but nobody knows how they work.
Right.
So that frustrated me because I was a mechanic and electrician that I am. So I talked to Bill and I said, gee, I would love to talk to John Cyril. You know, it'd just be fantastic to be able to talk to this man who built a machine that flew.
Yes.
And he says, well, I'll give you his number.
He has a number there, huh?
It's funny. He's the only man in the world who had his number.
Oh, wow. Oh, wow. And
so the synergy is there.
Yeah, to talk about it. Talk about the right place at the right time.
Right. So I hesitantly, got the nerve to finally call Professor Cyril, and I didn't know what to expect.
Yes.
Sometimes you get brushed off, and people, call me when you know something.
Right, exactly.
But in this case, it was just the opposite. I called him up and told him, how I got his number. And he started telling me about his technology.
Yes.
And he told me about it for the next 10 years. Actually, 18 years.
Yes.
And as you mentioned in the beginning there, John Cyril started with his dreams.
Yes.
And the dreams were in the form of nightmares. He had one dream, then another, and then later on in the year, he had those same two dreams, one right after another.
Hmm.
And he'd had that from the age of 4.5 to age 10.
Yes.
And they didn't make much sense to him. They scared him, but they made a big impression. And, of course, having had them so many times made even bigger impression.
Yes.
But it turned out they guided him his whole life and his entire work to build this machine.
Uh-huh.
And they crept up, and the meanings of the dreams became evident to him much later in life.
Right. You know, I've been looking through the book, and I've been looking at how this machine was constructed, how basically the components that were built up this device, and we'll get into that a little bit later. The first time that he constructed this, What was his focus? Because this thing can basically, it can generate electricity. It's like a magnetic generator, but much more than that, right?
Well, yes, and that was not his goal. His goal was to make a generator. He worked in a motor rewind shop at the age of 14.
Uh-huh.
And so he learned about, you know, motors and how to wind them and electromagnetic energy. And very, very quick learner and a very, very quick mind.
Yes.
And what he did is he brought some materials that he wanted to use, and he had an idea for making a little better generator.
Yes.
So he went to his landlady, financed him, actually. She actually paid for the materials. So he got some of the materials through his where he worked, and at a very, very cheap price.
Yes.
And then he took his... He had the magnets made. He had those made by a company who did that locally.
Uh-huh.
And then he had to get them magnetized to what he believed would be the best way for them to be done.
Yes.
And how he arrived at that exactly, I don't know. But I do know that he took it to two different magnetics firms, both each to have a specific way of magnetizing. And they both had to be magnetized. The companies had to be used to magnetize the single unit.
I see.
So he had these rollers and ring, and when he had them magnetized and he set the roller on the ring, it just kept going. It rolled around it.
Right.
And so he said, well, this is fantastic. So he has the first ring and roller set. He has 12 rollers in one ring. Then there's a second ring with another set of rollers, and they have to actually 10 more.
Yes.
And then a third set. So he's got three rings and a number of rollers, and then C-coils, which would pick up your electrons at the edge.
Right.
So this was fine. Everything was working. He had it. He brought it home. He had it on the kitchen table, the landlady there. And he hooked up the electric light to it, and he hooked up another light bulb, and then finally he hooked up what he called a cooker.
Uh-huh.
Which is like an oven, you know, an electric oven.
Sure.
And when he hooked up the cooker, the thing got very cold, he found out later,
uh-huh.
And it took off the table and hit the ceiling.
Well, that's interesting because it appears to me, because, okay, so he hooks up the light to it, it's generating electricity for the light, it's fine. When he hooks up the cooker, it requires a hell of a lot more power draw than the light bulb would, and that caused it to put out more power, which then it caused it to levitate, right?
Right. The unusual thing about this unit is it will always meet the load.
Yes.
And he wanted to load up the generator to see how much it could take before it burned out, uh-huh. as a conventional generator would.
Sure.
Or stop, at least. And so he kept building, you know, loading and loading, and never... It always met the load. And what happened was, again, the temperature dove down to about 4 Kelvin,
uh-huh.
and which is about absolute zero.
Right.
It's as low as all the superconductors that we have.
Yes.
And the temperature of that unit dropped that far. The unit went superconductive, and it generated its own gravity field, you found out later. And it took which repelled the earth and took off and hit the ceiling. So all this he didn't know. All he said is, well, that's a silly thing for it to do.
Yes.
I want it to stay on the counter and generate electricity.
Yes.
I wanted to hit the ceiling.
Take it off like a helicopter is probably what he thought, right?
So I asked him, John, how did you get it down? Well, he said, you got a stepladder. here's this thing with all these cookers and coffee makers hanging on it.
Yeah.
And he reaches up, and he says he grabbed it and pulled it down, was able to pull it down, and his hands froze to it.
Oh.
To the base.
Oh.
So they had to pour water on his hands. And the landlady stuck a screwdriver in it to stop
this thing from spinning.
Oh, God, he's just lucky it didn't shatter.
No,
I mean, so many things could have gone wrong.
Okay, that's a brave move there.
Yeah. Oh, I know. So then I got his hands out of it frozen. Luckily, they didn't do permanent damage. And so he said, okay. He said, we'll put this on hold for a little while. And he went and got, next day, he went out and got a big piece of lead, about 3 inches thick. It was very heavy. And he put this down and he mounted his generator on the lead plate, so this is going to keep this down.
Yes.
This isn't going anywhere. Well, so he put it down there, and then he loaded it all up again. Down goes the temperature, up goes the machine. This time it didn't stop.
Right.
It had all this potential energy in motion for the lead plate. And it went up through the kitchen ceiling, it went up through the bedroom ceiling, and went out through the roof.
Oh, because he just made it more.
So somewhere in space, some astronaut's going to look out the window, going to see a cooker.
Yeah.
And a coffee maker go by.
Maybe that's what they saw on the way to the moon when they radioed down and said, where's the second stage? There's something following us out here.
Yeah, right. Yeah, it's possible. He lost a number of them in space.
Really?
Oh, yeah. He lost, six total.
Oh, my. Oh, my. So, and that would make sense because he mounted it to the lead. But because of its such proximity and, of course, mounted to the device, it's caught in the gravity well, and it just becomes the same as everything else of the components, right?
Right. And what we've found, there's a lot of things that take place in the field.
Yes.
And now, this generator is a field. So he said, okay, he could build a generator and not load it up too high and use it effectively. But he also said if it wants to fly, let's give it a body.
Yes.
Let it fly.
Yes.
So with a lot of experimentation, he came up with a design that is, if you see my book there, it looks like a flying saucer.
Yes.
It's a saucer shape.
Yes.
It's actually a 14 and a half, 15 degree angle at the edge. So it's 7.5 degrees each way from
right.
the center. And they said, oh, well, he's got to be underground. So I dug up around his house. And there's no wires.
Yes.
And they actually went into his house and ripped out the wiring.
Oh, my. Oh,
and,
my.
And they destroyed his house. Yeah, you know, his wife and kids were there.
And they could do this by law at that time, right?
Yeah. So they go in there, find the generator, and that's to steal it. You know, and they confiscated it.
Did they ever give it back?
No.
No.
No, they said they said they destroyed it. They can't imagine.
They probably turned it on and it took off.
Maybe they did. I never thought of it. That's a good one.
We're at the top of the hour. We got to take our quick pause here. When we come back, we'll dive a little bit deeper into this. Fascinating stuff, I'm telling you. And after watching some of the videos, and I've been talking about this, I want to build one of these magnetic generators to generate power for the studio. Every time we have a big thunderstorm that comes through here and knocks us off, every time a raindrop falls out of the sky out here in Central Texas, the power infrastructure fails, and usually we suffer for it. And so I saw these videos of guys making small magnetic generators, and I'm a pretty bright guy. I'm not completely dumb. I thought that would be a great little project to put together. So I really want to do this. So, yes, indeed. All right, we'll be back after this. Stick around, everybody. It's Badlands Radio. It's Wednesday night. We're talking Serial Effect. We'll be back after this. Welcome back, everybody. Badlands Radio. Captain Jack here. I am your host. We're talking with John Thomas Jr. We're talking about the Serial Effect. John R.R. Serial. He made an incredible device many, many moons ago that if being used today would solve a lot of our problems, believe it or not. The device here's how it works. It's described as a generator. And it's made of four distinct material layers for both stator and rotor. That's basically the plate and the rings. And it functions with the same principles of linear motion, which multi-phase rollers riding on a magnetic bearing, if you will. And some of the things that, like for instance, what we talked about here at the first half of the program, that when he first activated, when John Searle first activated this thing, and he started hooking up devices to it, like lamps and other things to power it, whenever he hooked up a cooker to it, which would draw more energy, the thing went up into the ceiling. So he thought, I want to keep this thing down. He attached a piece of lead to it, thinking, okay, this is nice and heavy. This will keep it down. We've powered this baby up. Up it went again, because, again, it's generating basically a gravity well, if you will, around it. And the interesting thing is, I mean, the temperature dropped on this thing. It's really, really fascinating stuff. And this, the dreams that he has had from a young age, he built this thing when he was about 14 years old, which, come on. I mean, that's really, really fantastic. All right, John, welcome back to the program, first of all.
Thank you.
Let's talk a little bit about the device itself. So he, like you said, the first segment is that he actually went to a couple of different magnetic companies to build it. He had to go to two different magnetic companies, I would imagine, because one could do something the other couldn't. Why the two companies? What was the difference?
Well, one company was capable of magnetizing on an axial plane. And if you're familiar with magnets, it's a straight up and down north-south configuration.
Yes.
And the other magnetics company that he went to was for magnetizing radially.
Yes.
Which, I understand, is from the center out would be one pole would be outside, and the other pole would be on the inside.
Yes.
Well, there's an interaction between these two types of magnetization, and that's what gives him the thrust he needs. Originally, he had called this unit, we call it an SEG, or serial effect generator. Originally, it was called a gyro, flywheel, ball race, cyclotron, high energy density magnetic mechanical device.
Yes.
It was such a mouthful that a man that actually who coined the word S or the expression SEG was Gunnar Sandberg.
Yes.
And he was in the University of Sussex. And he was interested in this technology as well, and he agreed to do some testing on some pieces and some magnetics that John brought him. And wrote a number of papers on it.
Right. Interesting. So, where did he go after he dealt with them coming and basically confiscating his device? What happened then?
As he grew, and when he got to be about 21, in the meantime, he's experimenting and doing things on his own. And then when he got to Midlands Power Company, he was working there. Now, Midlands Power Company made dynamos. They made giant magnets and for generation of electricity and motors. So it was an ideal place for him to carry on with his work.
Yes.
So he was a foreman even at a young age of 21.
Yes.
And he was telling people about his device, a generator. And his boss said, oh, he said, I'll give you three choices. He said, you either got to, you got to shut up about that.
Yes.
Or you got to leave.
Right.
Or you got to do it. So he says, well, I didn't want to, I couldn't shut up. And I really didn't want to leave. He said, okay, I'll do it. So they agreed to let him use their facility and engineers.
Uh-huh.
And all he had to do was supply the raw material. Back then, raw material such as neodymium, which was used, is a rare earth, element number 60.
Yes.
And that was like 35 cents a kilogram. and it was only used at the time to color glass.
Yes.
So he was able to get that real cheap. And the other elements were quite inexpensive as well. There was Bakelite, there was nylon, there was some copper and a magnetic material on the second layer in. So he would take this and tell the engineers, the magnetics engineers, what he wanted to do.
Yes.
They had never heard of such a thing. Huh. That's why when he was young and he went to the different places to get his magnets magnetized, they were the only ones like that in the world. So when he told the magnetics engineers, they took it, instead of taking it as a scoffing and making fun of it and just dismissing it out of hand, like so many engineers will do, they took it took up the gauntlet, so to speak.
And yes.
And they said, okay, let's see if we can really do this. It's possible. And they rewound some of their equipment for magnetization,
uh-huh.
And they did it.
Really?
And it functioned properly. So while he was there, you know, he made these because he was, you know, he made it, and now he has to show it off.
Yes.
Because he has to prove that it does what he said it would do. And so he went outside.
Yes.
You know, with the cooker. And he went outside and they loaded the generator. And they had it tied down. And it was tied down with a quarter inch steel line.
Uh-huh.
Under a concrete block. And it broke loose.
Really? It broke the line?
It broke loose. And, I mean, when he loaded it up, it broke loose and I can't imagine, you know how many tons?
Yeah.
It would take to break a quarter inch steel line?
Yeah, you'd think that the concrete itself would come up out of the ground a little bit, too.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Well, here's the thing. I don't know how that concrete, what slab that was on, or concrete, or how deep it was, but I know it was really embedded deep.
Yes.
Because he hit another generator.
Oh.
And he hooked it up, and he turned it on, and he loaded it, and it took off. And he broke it. This one was a like 3/8 line.
Right.
So he got one. He said he can't do that anymore because he had to pay for the cable he was breaking.
So, understandably.
He said, I can't afford to do this anymore. So he had one last unit that he had made. And he put it down there, and they put in 1-inch steel line, and they put a 60-ton breakaway pin from a crane.
Uh-huh.
On that. And it broke it.
My word. So
60 tons.
So how much is it costing him per unit to make at this time?
Well, don't I wish we were in production.
Yeah, no kidding.
Yes, I do. And there's been so many setbacks. I could go on for hours on just the setbacks and what caused this. But let it suffice to say that we do not have a working unit as yet. It's been redone. Very, very expensive to redo this work today.
Right.
Where he had all the things that he needed right in front of him, including the expertise of his engineers.
Right.
And very cheap raw materials and a 2,000-ton press to make the magnets.
Yes.
Try to duplicate that today in today's market.
Oh, yeah. It's very, very, very expensive.
We're down. We're still shy of about almost $500,000 to finish the first prototype.
Wow. So.
Once you get that done, of course, then you have, you know, it's like making a brick. Somebody told you to go make a brick.
Right, exactly.
It would cost a lot of money.
Exactly.
Once the factory's in place, you know, it costs you time.
Exactly. Well, you know, I'm sure that you know, paying attention to a lot of the different research with magnets now would even enhance the design to better it, wouldn't it?
You mean the advancements in magnetics?
Yes.
Yes. As a matter of fact, I mean, I can't say for certain, but when John Searles used neodymium in his mixture and the first ones were mixtures,
uh-huh.
not layers, to make his magnets. I think it's the first time that neodymium iron boron was ever used.
Right.
So he was never getting the credit for that, of course. But
yes,
it's an insight that he had that's not from conventional knowledge.
Yes.
You know, these dreams opened up a whole doorway into what he called the Law of the Squares.
The Law of the Squares. Tell me about that.
Now, the Law of the Squares is a system that shows, it's like a coherent number system.
Uh-huh.
And it's a reflection of nature, how nature is put together. Now, if you visualize, say, a 4x4 square, meaning four squares in a row from left to right, and then from top to bottom. So you've got this grid work of four different squares.
Yes.
Okay. Now, if you put the numbers in those, you can put them in what they call a magic square. Most of the time you see that done 3x3, but you can do it 4x4. And what that means is that every number or every line from left to right, or top to bottom, or diagonally, each of those lines add up to the same number.
I see.
That means it's a balanced square. And the everything that to do with the SEG and with the IGV, the inverse G vehicle,
mm-hmm.
everything to do with that is dependent on these squares. You couldn't make it without them.
Right.
All the weights, all the dimensions, all of the elements, even the dimensions of the internal rooms in the IGV are all determined using the squares.
I see. And this is information that he received in these dreams, right?
Yes, this is where he started with. Well, the dreams were, he had, for 10 years, he had these dreams.
Right.
And so they made, as I said, they made a big impression. Well, the dreams were always in his mind then. So he went to when he was in the motor rewind,
uh-huh.
he saw somebody write down, you know, 4 squared. You know, like 4 with a little 2 above it.
Right.
And he said, well, what's that? He said, well, it's 4 squared. You know, he said, well, what do you mean squared? Well, I tried to explain it to him. But what he got out of it was that it was like it would be 4, like a 4 square.
I see.
See?
Right.
But you can see this on our web page. You can see it on other web pages. You can see it in my book. So those that are listening, trying to visualize what I'm saying, there is help out there.
Yes. Because, you know, that's one of the things about the book is it's more than just telling the story. It really gets into the science behind this.
Yeah.
And the real dynamics of how this device works.
Oh, yeah. This is a tremendous device. It is a open-ended generator. It's not a closed system. It's open-ended. And it has a rare earth in it.
Yes.
And the rare earth, it supplies the electrons. And it has 4 extra electrons in the 4F band of the atom that will release easily and also replenish it easily.
Right.
So you have that. And the next layer out is like a nylon. It's an insulator. Actually, more of a dielectric, because this acts like a solid-state device.
Yes.
So you have a supplier of electrons, you have a gate, the electrons are limited in their flow by either a Teflon or a nylon.
Mm-hmm.
Then you go to a magnetic layer, which is your third layer.
Yes.
And then the fourth layer, which is your copper.
Yes.
So as it runs, as it begins to move, you know, we'll get to move because of a magnetic waveform that is impressed upon the roller and on the ring. And that's why he had to go to 2 different places originally and was able to do this all in one shot at Midlands.
Right.
So you've got this magnetic waveform. Now, conventional scientists have said, oh, you can't do that. Well, we've got actual footage, and I've got the actual magnets in my home
uh-huh.
that show that there is a waveform that has been impressed upon it. We've done that.
Right.
So now then they said, well, you can't have rollers on a ring. They'll never work.
one
hold up. You can't do it. Well, we've done it.
They're saying that eventually there's going to have some sort of breakdown of the unit.
Right. And they won't, because the rollers don't ever touch the ring.
I see. They just kind of like the train that rides on the magnetic track. It never
absolutely
really touches the track. It just, and without that friction, it can go very, very fast.
See, the SVG is a round linear motor.
Mm-hmm.
It's just a closed loop.
Yes.
So it's exactly what you said is true. It's like the maglev trains.
Right.
And there's an eddy current that actually causes the roller to push away from the ring a few thousandths of an inch,
mm-hmm.
so it never touches, so you have no friction.
Yes.
So all of the rollers are running the same, so it's a frictionless device that's putting out electrons.
So you don't need any of the lubrications for the unit to, you know, keep it from heating up and breaking down or seizing up or temperature changes. Now, what about the temperature changes, actually, the extreme cold that it's generating, the explanation for that?
Well, the extreme cold, the explanation. Well, the explanation is that the unit is putting out hundreds of millions of volts. I mean, it gets really very high, very high voltage.
Yes.
It pushes the air away from the device, causing a vacuum.
Yes.
And the vacuum then is being saturated with electrons at high speed, actually high spin electrons.
Right.
That, in turn, creates the cold.
I see.
And the cold allows for superconductivity. So the more it works, the colder it gets, the better it works.
Right, indeed. So when you got in touch with John,
yes.
You got to see some of this stuff firsthand in time, right?
Oh, absolutely, yeah. I held a number of magnets that he had recovered when he got out of jail, and he recovered some of his magnetics. I had held them in my hand. I did some testing on them.
Yes.
I measured them. Did all I could at the time to document what they were. Took pictures of them. Those, I believe, the pictures are on our website.
Right, right. Lots of pictures in the book near the end of it, showing the construction of the body that you were talking about, and all the different designs. Let me ask you a question here. With what this device can do, is there any way to control its propulsion instead of going just straight up, maybe yes. causing it to go straight up so far? And
I'm glad we got there. That's the when he said he wants to give it a body, he did, and the three that went up. Actually, we kind of stopped there because the old man who funded him to do these, he did three of them.
Yes.
And all three were lost.
Yes.
So, but to answer your question, there was a way found on how to control it.
Mm-hmm.
He found out that if you take it, there's a series of switches on the IGV.
Uh-huh.
And there's a 64 fins, or 64 points on the outside edge.
Yes.
Representing the 15 or the 64 struts that are inside. Now, what he can do is he can power up, they're what they're called load cells, that are toward the edge.
Uh-huh.
He can power them up on the top or the bottom, or turn them,
uh-huh.
and power them that way too. He can also power the entire shell of the craft on the top or the bottom. So what he did, and this is all remote control. Don't
right.
forget, this is back when they had vacuum tubes. There were no transistors.
Right.
So this is not any small unit. So this, I think, is the P-11, I believe, was 19 foot, I believe. And what he did is he would put more voltage on the top, allow more voltage to be on the top than on the bottom, and that would allow the craft to take off slowly. See, the craft wants to take off like crazy.
Yes.
And the fact that it broke a 60-ton pin or even the quarter-inch line is phenomenal. This is not anti-gravity. This is not just an equal force of gravity that they have it a little higher so it lifts off.
Right.
This is using the ether.
Right.
It's using the vacuum energy of space, which is all around us, is the most powerful thing we can think of.
Exactly.
So he would do is he'd take these out, and by remote control, he would fly them.
Uh-huh.
So he would also give demonstrations. He rented out one of the fair sites, or, you know, that they have when they have the carnivals that come.
Sure.
So he went in the green there, and he rented that out, and he put on a demonstration. But he couldn't get anybody to come there that was from the scientific community.
Uh-huh.
And they wouldn't come. So he ended up putting on a show for just the people there.
Yes, unless they did show up and didn't officially say that they maybe sent someone down there, go take a look at what this guy's doing here.
Oh, yeah. Well, he would send the craft up in the air and then turn it around and have it come towards the ground at breakneck speed. And everybody would be gasping and running, and he would, at the last second, stop it.
Just
before it hit the ground.
Just stop it just like that.
Just like that. Now, what happened, I'm going to get my notes here. It's a side note here. President John Kennedy was approached with this device as far as what it was and what it could do.
Yes.
And he directed the military to look into it.
Yes.
And at that point, the craft was brought over to the United States by ship,
uh-huh.
and it was brought to Edwards Air Force Base
uh-huh.
for a team of about, I think it was like 12 or 13 officers and the scientists were going to test this unit.
Yes.
See what it would do. So when they fired it up and they ran it, to follow the directions, and they took it off. And they went down range for like a mile or so and stopped, and then came back and stopped dead, and then did turns that would have been maybe 20 Gs, something that would kill any pilot inside.
Right.
And then and they said, they said, that's one of the things. They said, well, this will kill anybody inside it. It's impossible to use, and we don't understand it.
Mm-hmm.
We don't understand the principle. So we're not interested.
They weren't thinking how useful drones would be here in the future now, were they?
Well, the thing, here's the clincher. When he did some tests, he took the old-style test equipment. You had to take out the graph paper.
Yes.
The round graph paper, that's a lot of them. And so he had replaced that. He put that in. And then he would take it up and run it through his fast turns, quick stops, up and down, and come back and he'd look at the graph paper for forces.
Yes.
Forces acting. And it just stayed at 1/2 G force, a straight line.
Really? So
he says, this is something's wrong. This can't be right. So he put another unit in there, instrument.
Uh-huh.
And he got the same result.
Very little G.
What he did then is he bought a vial that had a radioactive gas in it that would set up so it would break if there was over 2 Gs in any direction. This vial would break.
Yes.
It's kind of one of those things where it has to work.
Yes.
And they sent it up there and did the same thing and brought it back down and it didn't break.
Did he ever try putting an animal in it?
No.
No?
No, but he said that, because here's the thing. The craft generates a vacuum all around itself.
Uh-huh.
You need life support, whether you're in the atmosphere or not.
Yes.
Because it eliminates the air right out of it.
I see.
So a man approached John, and he was a radio announcer. He wanted to, as a stunt, get in the craft, have John bring the craft for radio control over in the middle of a stadium, and then have him get out. So he said, oh, no, he wants to do this, and he's all excited. And John said, no, you can't do that.
Yeah, you'll just fall out of carcass.
He said, I'll get one of those scuba things. He says, well, yeah, first of all, it gets very, very cold.
Yes.
And then you don't have, and if you don't know what a vacuum does to a person, you wouldn't want to have it.
Yes.
In the middle of the stadium.
come see everybody. All right, we're at the.
Here he is, all over.
Yeah, exactly. We're at the bottom of the hour. When we come back, we'll talk about a little bit about some of the trials and tribulations and rough times that John has gone through on this. So stick around, everybody. It's Badlands Radio. It's Wednesday night. We'll be back right after this. Tonight we're talking about the Searle effect. It's an effect based on magnetic fields that generates a continual motion of magnetized rollers around magnetized rings. It produces electric energy and under certain conditions, an anti-gravity effect that can be used for propulsion. And there's many side effects to this device, which we'll get into here in a moment. And I want to point this out, that all of John Searle's work was recorded by the BBC News and by the newspapers, and the BBC ran a weekly piece on Professor Searle's work and progress for almost a year. These television broadcasts showed the Levity disc in flight and gave updates on the work being done. This was all documented by a news source, and of course now they won't give any of that stuff up. My guest tonight, John Thomas, joins me. He became friends with John Searle and got to see some of this stuff firsthand. He's outlined basically, how things started out for him and how basically this thing works and some of the things that it could do. At one point, John F. Kennedy even, put the military into looking into this. They brought this thing over. They looked at it. They said, wait a minute, the force of the speed of this thing would kill anybody on board. We're not interested in this thing. But when John did tests on the G-forces, there was very little G-force at all on this thing. But then in time, as John Searle's work continued, he had some ups and downs, lots of ups, lots of downs, and we're going to talk to John more about this. John, welcome back.
Thank you.
Tell me a little bit about some of the incredible hurdles that John Searle has encountered throughout his life of dealing with this device.
Well, you're right. There has been a lot of things, a lot of hardship and a lot of very hard work that went into building this device.
Yes.
He was driven, always been driven. He told me that he was always pointed in the direction of completing this work, no matter what he tried to do. Once he was offered a scholarship to Oxford to become a physician.
Mm-hmm.
And that was stopped by because he was still living under the supervision of an orphanage home.
Yes.
Dr. Bernardo's. And they would not let him go. It was probably because they were getting money.
Yes.
And so that was a big opportunity that lost to him, and there was many, many others. There's other things that have stopped it. I mean, we don't like to dwell on it too much. I mean, people have been trying to cheat him and to coerce him and, in some cases, actually torture him in order to gain the knowledge that they know he has.
Yes.
And that was done right up through his, actually, he was in the Air Force, and he was actually put through some terrible things there with the object of trying to get people to get him to tell them how his devices worked.
Really?
And they loaded him up with saline solution until his skin was ready to pop, and then they let it out.
How did that come about? Why? What's the story behind that?
Well, at the age of, that was when he was really young. He went into the Air Force, and as a very young man. And he made these things They were not quite an STG, the same as STG, but they would fly.
Yes.
And they were, there's some things out today that, are similar to that, just high voltage. And they wanted to know what his, you know, how he did it, what his secret was.
Yes.
And he refused to tell them. And but we don't. I don't go into that. Matter of fact, this is the first time I've mentioned it.
Yes.
And I'm kind of sorry I did. we don't like to get into all the depressing parts.
Right,
right now, this is, the only thing that's depressing is the fact that we don't have this in every home today.
Right. Right.
He did go. One of the things that he did do, he used to take the model and he didn't have any place to put it. When he, you know, it's a 21 footer.
Mm-hmm.
And so he used to put it up in stationary orbit.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then come back in a week and have it come down with radio control. And then he would check all his charts and then set it back up.
Uh-huh.
Well, as it happened, a news crew was going by on their way somewhere else and saw him with a craft. And saw him,
I can imagine how that was, what that was like for them as they were driving by.
And he put this, you know, he changed the charts and he took off. Well, come back in a week, and he brought the craft down, and all of a sudden he felt a hand on his shoulder, and he thought it was this. His buddy, and he said, "We got to quit fooling around." He said, "We got to get going. You know, somebody might come."
Uh-huh.
And he turned around, and he was the Air Commodore of Great Britain.
Uh-huh.
And he says, "I just saw you send that up. When's it coming down?"
Huh.
He says, "In 7 days." He said, "No, no. What do you mean 7 days? No, it's coming down 7 days. When I bring it down." I can only be here on Sunday because I work all week.
Yes.
So he said, so they waited. They camped out. They waited for this thing to come down for like a couple of days. It never came down. So until the next Sunday. And they, so the Air Commodore of Great Britain went on television and said that he told the people that they saw what he saw. And he said that John Searle, if he continues on the same vein, will be the Lord Master of the airways, you know. It'll be U.S. and Russia the boot.
Yes.
So it was but some of the things that he found out, like when he was when he first found out that he could fly these units.
Yes.
They would scoop out about a half circle of dirt out of the ground as they took off.
Uh huh.
And then they would also be scorched. So he said, he didn't just go and make an IGV and have it work. He had to do some, he had to do a lot of experimenting.
Right.
What he found out later on is that the elements were laid up from on his originals with a neodymium on the outside.
Uh-huh.
And as a result, the force field that was generated was focused in the center.
I see.
So even though he got it to run and he got it to take off, it hit this force field that was concentrated in the center and to get this matter snatch, this scoop. So what he did is he decided he changed the way the elements were laid up. And they went from the rare earth in the center and then it went out from there. And then everything went great.
So I'm picturing in my mind, I'm picturing much like the disc itself, mm-hmm. and the center energy running through the exact center of the disc, and it kind of just moves up and down on this energy. Is that basically correct?
Well, it's similar, yeah. You've got, but you end up with a toroid.
Yes.
See, a large toroid field. So, you know, in a torus field, a toroid field,
mm-hmm.
you have the field will come out from the edge and then fold back in like a donut.
Right.
Toward the center. Now, the center is shielded, and the center is where the people would be in the controls.
Right.
And then on the out from the center is where you could put your storage that wouldn't be affected by the field.
Right. So how big does this thing have to be? Does it have to be a certain size for it to work? Or can you construct something the size of a dinner plate?
I have John Searle's original plans to build a one, what is it? 1,000 meter craft.
Yes.
Which is a giant craft.
That's like, big.
It's like the saucer section in the Star Trek.
Yes, that's big. That's damn big.
Yeah. And, no, it can be done as long as it's done according to the squares.
Yes.
Everything has to be done according to the squares or it won't work.
Right.
And, but he did, all of his flights were done remote control.
Mm-hmm.
He never had a manned flight because he could never afford the life support.
Right.
But he did fly the P-1 with the help of ham radio operators completely around the world.
Oh, really?
Yeah. He would set it on a course, and then he would be in ham, his ham radio would be in contact with the other hams and tell them what time and what place in the sky this unit would be coming over and to send a certain signal for a correction in flight path.
Okay, was John responsible for any of the UFO sightings that happened around that time?
Oh, yeah.
Really?
Let me tell you what he did. This scamp. but he was driving. They were out testing this unit, and they had it in the end of the truck.
Yes.
And so he sees this guy pulling down the side road with this young girl. So somewhere around noontime. So he says, "Let's have a bit of fun." He says.
Oh my, I can see where this is going.
What he did is he brought the craft and landed in the road right in front of this guy.
Uh-huh.
He says, "You never heard gears grind so bad in your life."
Trying to get in reverse?
Oh, he could. He was trying to get in reverse. He went back out of the road. Never looked. Nothing. He was gone.
I probably would have been, too.
The worst thing about it is because of who he was with, he probably couldn't tell anybody.
Yeah, no kidding. Yes, you probably never...
But there's some other things, stories like that that are... One is that he was the same day they were out, and they saw a farmer who was picking up hay, bales that they had baled with the baler earlier. And what he had is he had his tractor in gear, but yes. He was off of it.
Yes.
And he was walking behind it, and he was picking up the hay bales and throwing them on the flatbed.
Yes.
It was a very sunny day, beautiful day. So what John did is he took this craft up behind him and then put it right above him, so he was in the shade.
Look at him.
Now, you got to know, there's no trees around.
Yes, yes.
In the middle of the field. So he got to, and all of a sudden the farmer stops what he's doing, and he kind of looks around on the ground and sees the shade, and he looks up, and he says he dropped the hay bale and ran up to the house. And John says, "The only thing I really regret is I couldn't hear what he told his wife, why the tractor was in the ditch."
So he just, "The hell with the tractor, I'm the hell out of here."
That's right. That was it.
Well, what happened to this one that he was able to fly around and do these things with? What happened to it?
Well, the all of the craft were, I mean, he built 40 of them all together.
Yes.
And at certain times there was actually two in existence at a time, at different times. What happens, he would build one, and then he would learn from it.
Yes.
He would take it apart and strip it and sell the parts or whatever and get new ones.
Sure.
And they'd build the next generation and the next. And
sure.
The next. And one time he had two 40-foot craft in the air.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's a good significant size.
40-footers are, you know, They were big.
That's the size. I mean, you think of a semi-trailer as you're passing it on the freeway. I mean, that's 48 feet.
Yeah.
So just 8 feet shy of that in circumference, a disc, that's a big disc.
And he said that they weighed almost 40 ton each.
Where the hell did he store these things?
That's the problem.
Uh-huh.
He did not have own any land.
Uh-huh.
And he couldn't get anybody to store them, so what he did is he stored them in space.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah. And he was still controlled by remote control.
Uh-huh.
But he parked them up in the... And the thing is, it's really a shame because I guess, you know, maybe it's called paranoia or maybe it was justified, but he had units in the craft that had to be reset by a signal every 7 days.
Uh-huh.
And if they weren't, it shut it down and you couldn't reset it.
Right.
Well, he got in trouble with at different times with the police. They arrested him. He was they put him in jail. He could not get out to send that signal.
To reset him. How was he sending the signal? I know that with remote control, depending, because RF is right up my alley.
Yeah.
What was he using to actually control the device? Because he would have to have a hell of a lot of RF output to reach a signal to it, wouldn't he?
He did. He did. He had surplus military gear.
Uh-huh.
And matter of fact, I don't know if I've got that right here or not. The military told him that, you know, he was illegally using certain bandwidths.
Because he was transmitting this signal.
Right, and so, but when he explained what he was doing and showed them, it's funny, they allowed him to continue to use it.
I bet.
Yeah, I bet. So, I mean, this has been around for a while.
Yes.
And, they allowed him to use this, so, and it was, I forgot the bandwidth right now, but, it was a military bandwidth, and he did have a good power supply.
Would the temperature of the device cause any type of havoc with the internal system, or is it sitting in the center of this where the donut, if you will, the donut field, isn't interfering with the electronics at all?
Well, the very center is there is no gravity at all.
Yes.
And think you can put all of your equipment in that center section. That would also be cold, and that would probably, you'd have to, you can't let everything go super cold all the time because then it'll stop, some of it might stop functioning.
Sure.
That part of it is shielded. That's the only part that you can, this craft is invisible to radar.
Oh, really? It's stealthed.
It's stealth.
Well, I would imagine that it would
really
cause...
stealth because it absorbs the radar.
I see. So it's absorbing a radio frequency. That means that on a particular frequency, such as this communication device, that's not being absorbed. That's actually that's actually passing through the field. But radar, because of the frequency that it's on, is being absorbed or distorted, for that matter.
Right. Well, what happens is at the very center of the craft, you can put an antenna out and you can send a signal.
Yes.
Or receive a signal. Any other power, any other signal, or any other power like a laser or anything else that came close to the field would be absorbed by that field.
Uh-huh.
Radar especially.
Uh-huh.
So instead of not bouncing it back or dispersing it at an angle, it just absorbs it completely, so there's no bounce back at all, so it's physically, according to radar, not there.
I see.
And he flew them all, he flew, as I said, all around the world.
Yes.
He was flying, and then he could land them. What he could do is have somebody could actually land the craft in another place,
mm-hmm.
using the same radio frequency.
All right, we're at the top of the hour. We're going to take a quick break. When we come back, we're going to dive into the question of why this isn't in homes, Now, the magnetic generators that I've been talking about here for a couple of weeks now, I've seen some fantastic videos of these things on YouTube. I got a chance to see one up close and personal from a town that is really experimenting a lot with this thing. I mentioned here as we came out of the last break that there's some side effects to this. And I know that magnetics have been used for healing properties. We'll dive into that as well when we come back. Stick around, everybody. It's Badlands Radio. It's Wednesday night. John Thomas is my guest, talking about this serial effect. We'll be back after this. Welcome back, everybody. Here we are, Badlands Radio, Wednesday night. Jimmy, I walked out of the studio here a little while ago, and Jimmy told me that... Because he sits by this big glass sliding door, and he said that suddenly there's a big flash of light out there outside, yet the skies are crystal clear out here. We may hear about midnight or 1 o'clock, midnight, 1 o'clock central time, probably midnight. We'll probably be firing up the night vision, the live night vision camera. Here, since we have clear skies and we've got some activity in the skies here tonight, so we'll be doing that. Tonight we're talking with John Thomas Jr. We're talking about the Cyril effect, John R.R. Cyril, and his story of this device that he has built that not only generates electricity, free energy, if you will, but also anti-gravity. The military at one time even looked at it and said, oh, wait a minute, no. This thing is too many G-forces in this. It would kill anybody on board if we tried to use it for any type of propulsion. The study was done on it. Here's some of the publications that has covered John's story, John Cyril. Life Magazine, USA. Times TV program, Today in Great Britain. There's also on Saturday Tidbits. It was covered on Saturday Tidbits. 10 days before I was born, it was October 2nd, 1971. 10 days before I was born. The list goes on and on. Great U.S. Bureau of Astrodynautics in 1974 here in the USA. ATV Television, Great Britain. BBC Television coverage every month. I mentioned that here in the last couple of segments. They're all covering what John had done. Yet we don't see his work in the public sector in any way, or maybe we do. I asked John here if there was ever a time that maybe he was responsible for some of the UFO sightings, and he said, "Oh yeah." All right, let's get John back in here. John, welcome back.
Thank you. Bandwidth was a 21-meter band.
21-meter band. So that's what he was using, 21...
A beacon.
Yes.
To send out a frequency so you could track it that way.
Yes. Yeah, kind of like a transponder in a sense.
Yeah.
I see. So, but anybody with that could listen in on that frequency and record, I would imagine, would be tones. Although we've done that with our audio broadcast, of course. Certain tones
right.
Be sent through, trigger certain things.
No, I'm going home.
Uh-huh.
He went home into the field of his SCG and returned to the hospital for 14 days. When they took the bandages off, he had baby skin.
Really? From being around this device?
That's right. For being in the field. See, the field actually, in your house, every time you turn a light on or turn something on, that's a flow of electrons through there.
Right.
And it actually enhances your environment.
I think if people really realized just exactly how many frequencies were radio frequencies and were traveling through their body on a daily basis, some people would probably even get a little concerned about that, wondering about the health effects. I know that living next to high tension wires with that 60 hertz signal, studies have shown that it has adverse effects on the health, but I also know that magnetics have been used for healing properties, and NASA has looked into this a lot.
Well, you see, because this is made according to the law of the squares, which is nature reflected in numbers, because everything is in balance. This can be seen in some of the web pages too. I think I've got this on the web page on the square four. It's, you know, everything is balanced perfect.
Yes.
And so if you build something like that, it's the closest thing to a living organism.
Yes.
It's built in harmony and perfect with nature. So if you're in a field that has been generated by a device such as this, it's going to be beneficial.
Right.
And we would like to see one of these units in every burn response vehicle,
mm-hmm.
and fire department vehicle,
mm-hmm.
that there is, because...
Yeah, because,
it
really does do something to the cellular structure. Magnetic fields have very interesting effects on cellular structure, and that's one of the most crucial things in burn victims is recouping that cellular structure that has been damaged, correct?
Right, and he explains, one of the things he explains, it says that, you know, when you burn, all the electrons and everything go out of its tissue.
Yes.
And this pumps it back in. It actually pumps the negative electrons into the skin to replace them and replace the burn section.
You know, I had a health teacher in middle school that she had been struck by lightning twice in her life. And she had more negative ions around her body. She couldn't wear, like, a wristwatch, for example. It would go dead. The batteries would drain on us. She could only wear one of those pendant style digital watches because everything else was done. And a lot, we didn't believe her at the time. And she went through and she proved it on many levels. This was like a topic of conversation a lot in the classroom was what happened to her. But the ionic energy around an individual and the magnetic field properties. And this thing, like what we talked about at the beginning of the program, once he hooked up that cooker to it, it had more of an energy draw to power that cooker, which caused it to just naturally produce more energy.
Oh, yeah. Just the more, and that's why in the craft, the engine has to weigh 7 times more than the rest of the craft.
Yes.
And that has to do with balance of nature and how it works.
Yes. Well, there is some interesting things coming out of Lockheed Martin, where Boyd Bushman from Lockheed Martin has revealed to people like David Sirita, and David Sirita's had a firsthand look at some of these generators being dropped into wing sections of aircrafts that are being hoisted into wing sections by cranes,
mm-hmm.
which these things are incredibly, incredibly heavy and can cause the craft, once they're locked in and once they're powered up, you'd think, okay, there's no way this thing can fly. The weight behind this is too enormous,
mm-hmm.
but it's lifting off the ground. So we know that Lockheed Martin has experimented with anti-gravity, and they do have some working things. And now I'm fully convinced, also invisibility, complete invisibility. How much do you think of this, connects, back and forth? Why is it that we don't have some of John's work in all of our homes?
We should. That's a big question. And people should be, not only concerned, but kind of mad. Why don't I have this? Why can't we get this?
Yes.
And there are people who don't want you to have the freedom and peace of mind of having your own electrical generator.
That's true.
They want to have control of you.
That's right. Because that's an enormous amount of money.
These things have been stopped. I've been in contact at different times with Lockheed Martin and trying, even the fellow, the head of the Skunk Works, and trying to get him to interested enough to take a look at this
uh-huh.
and to do it. But they won't. I haven't had any response.
Right.
So, these things have not, it's not as though they haven't been offered. As you mentioned, there was the fairgrounds and demonstration and government demonstrations.
Right.
Proving that there's zero inertia inside should have been enough.
Right.
You can't, people say, well, if you get in a rocket and you go too fast, toward Mars, then you got to spend the halfway mark to slow down.
Yes.
Even if you only travel at 1G. Well, if you don't have the 1G to worry about, you can be there in hours.
That's true.
The flying speed of the craft in space is 138,000 miles per second.
Yes.
Per second.
That's pretty fast.
It's almost light speed.
Yes.
So we're not talking about, you know, a one-month trip to Mars or anything. We're talking possibly even star travel, because we don't know whether or not light speed is a ceiling, just like we didn't know that the speed of sound.
Right, exactly. Exactly. And there is some interesting research actually showing that the speed of light is not the fastest thing, that you could actually travel faster than the speed of light because of gravity itself. I mean, we were seeing evidence of this within theories because of gravity.
Right. There's a study at the poles where they analyzed the cosmic rays coming to the poles.
Exactly.
Faster than the speed of light.
Exactly. Exactly. So what is the state of John right now? I mean,
we've gone quite a bit. We finally got a backer.
Yes.
Although the money's run out now, but as far as it went, we built a magnetizing unit.
Yes.
This is in Thailand.
Yes.
So the magnetizer unit has been built, and the elements have been procured,
mm-hmm.
and we're still looking at some of the magnetic coils that have to be wound. We're still about close to a 500,000 short of finishing. But there's been a great deal of money already invested, and we're making a lot of progress. There's things have been proven that they said it couldn't be done. I think I mentioned it before. The sine wave, they said, couldn't be done. We've done it.
Right.
The fact that you have an eddy current that lifts the roller off, there's an experiment shown on the web. You can see that it's floating. And so that roller is shown to be floating on a spinning copper disc, which shows you the eddy current interaction and the levitation of the roller.
Yes.
So we've got... and then there's a mock-up of the SEG that I'm sure you've seen on YouTube.
Yes.
Where you've got the roller spinning around.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, they said that the scientists said they couldn't do that, that the rollers couldn't be suspended, that they would sag, they wouldn't fit. There's so many things that we've proven that go along with what John Searle has said right from 1946.
Right.
And as we go through, instead of disproving, we're proving the things that he said would happen.
Right. Now,
so those things are all said. Now, what we're looking for is somebody to step up and let us finish this so we can go into a manufacturing mode,
mm-hmm.
and give people freedom.
Who do you think would, because I know that there's some companies out of Australia right now that have a working, active sales model of a magnetic generator that can put out 110 volts. I can't think of the amperage off the top of my head, but it's significant enough to power sections of your home. There's even instructions exactly how to rewire your home for this unit and gone through all the safety stuff. So when it comes to manufacturing for this, because energy is a very hot topic right now, you would think that there's going to be people kind of tripping over themselves. Does the anti-gravity aspect of it kind of throw them a little bit where they step back from it?
Well, it's possible. We've got a redundant safety system designed for when they go into production.
Yes.
We'll have a standard breaker type of arrangement. If you overload the breaker,
yes.
It'll blow. Then you'll have... an internal, you'll have a potted section which will be internally fused. So, you know, anything that happens the whole thing will shut down and it will not lift.
Right.
It's not taking a roof off.
It's not gonna be attached to your house and create a gravity well that makes you wind up in Oz.
I'm interested about that. The one in Australia. Send me the link when we get on.
Yes, absolutely. As a matter of fact, there's some YouTube videos out there about it. I'll get those over to you.
I know that this... You see, people are hanging on to their money, and I understand that if things were status quo.
Oh.
But we've got a 2012 coming up.
Yes.
And whether you're a skeptic or not, there's too many things that have pointed toward some sort of disaster.
You know, you would think currently right now for the average person, it is money's incredibly tight. But today, while I was just happened to hop on over to eBay find some birthday gifts and stuff, I found on today they're bidding. There's five bidders right now. There's 23 bids total, a total of $39,702.99 for a five-person dinner with Sarah Palin. So if they've got $39,000 to toss out to have dinner with Sarah Palin, you would think that they would be, you know, someone out there that had $39,000 to pitch in for something this important.
Well, I hope that people listen in on this program because, you know, your money's not going to be worth anything. You can be a millionaire, a billionaire. It doesn't make any difference. If we have a global-type catastrophe, something we have to fight off globally,
yes,
the money system is going to collapse. It's not going to be worth anything.
All right.
So the paper is only going to be worth what you get heat you can get out of it when you burn it. You got to get out of the mindset of money and cash and ownership and control. We're talking survival now.
Right.
And if something happened and all the electricity is out, I would like to have electricity.
Oh yes, I mean, like I said here during the program, that when a raindrop seems to fall out of the sky, our electrical infrastructure fails. It just does.
I would like to have a generator.
Yeah, that's exactly why I'm so interested in, and I've been looking into more of these magnetic generators, and I've seen one that people put together not too far from me that's doing a very, very excellent job of running a couple of trailer home-style facilities with everything from computers to light bulbs. They're LED light bulbs to conserve on energy.
Yeah.
But it makes sense, and it's working very well. They have a couple of blink outs here and there, but for the most part, they are free from the electric company.
Well, that sounds great.
Yeah.
So you gone to see him yet?
Oh yes. Oh yes, and it sparked me. And I've worked with M5 magnets for a while now, and those things, they're incredibly powerful little magnets. They really are. For the size of them, they're incredibly powerful, and you just don't want to get a couple of those suckers stuck together. I mean, they can be dangerous when you
get... I've got some that will take the skin right off your hand if you're not careful.
That's right. They're incredibly dangerous. So you get several of these, let's say 30 or 40 of these things in a row, you better make darn sure they're nice and secure, because if they snap together, if something breaks and they snap together, you're going to have shards, very sharp shards flying out. But once it's constructed, the energy force behind it is, the strength of it is incredible.
Yeah.
And I'd like to run my studio off of it, quite frankly. We're at the bottom of the hour. We're going to take a quick break here. When we come back, we'll talk a little bit more about where people can go to find out more about this, where they can get the book, where they can watch the YouTube videos, the lectures, they can do the research themselves on this story, and you decide. You absolutely decide. If you got any questions, throw them up into the shout box on paranormalradioshow.net, and Jimmy will pass them on over to me. and we'll ask John those the questions, whatever you've got. Throw them out there. We'll be back right after these messages. Stick around. Badlands Radio, Black Heart of Texas, Wednesday night. In 1946, a young boy of 14 built a device that lost its gravity and flew up and hit the ceiling of the room where he assembled it. This was done by a boy at the age of 12. He could neither read or write, but he was given this new technology in the form of dreams, which he received from the age of 4.5 to the age of 10. There were two dreams that came twice per year. It was left to him to decipher these dreams and apply the technology that they represented. He has been doing just that for 58 years. This technology has been named the Law of the Squares by Professor Cyril and has been developed into the extent that he ran his home on these generators for 30 years and has sent flying discs into orbit around the Earth and received them to check on the effects of space. And this was done in 1968. Since that time, many things have transpired to try to stop the efforts of this great endeavor. They almost succeeded, but in 1990, Professor Cyril decided to give his technology to the world in the form of a series of books entitled The Law of the Squares. This book that I am talking about here tonight, which is Anti-Gravity, The Dream Made Reality, the story of John R.R. Cyril, written by John Thomas, my guest tonight, goes through the outline of how all this started, some of the great conversations that John and John have had together, and where it's all gone, where it's all going, and where could someone probably pick up and go with this. Now, we're going to talk about exactly how you can do your own research on this and find out more about this story, as well as get the books or watch the DVDs or anything on YouTube, or even maybe even contribute to the research. John, welcome back to the program.
Thank you.
Tell me a little bit about, because you talked about that there has been some investors here recently that have kind of stepped forward and tried to help out with things. But more needs to be done, for what you're saying.
Right, right. There's been investors, and there still are other investors that were having a look at the project. We have things that we can show them.
Yes.
To show how the work is being, how it's being done and how it's progressing.
Yes.
I'm trying to get people into the right frame of mind as far as if you've got, if you are an investor, you do have money that you're, you know, classically people want to know, okay, when's my return? How quick is it?
Right.
And that's the money mentality of,
right,
of the whole world. Actually.
Sure.
But if you look at it from a little bit different angle, you want to do something good with it, and you want to do something good for yourself, but also for other people and for the planet.
Sure.
If you, by running these generators, if you ran generators instead of gasoline engines and automobiles, you know, we could clean up the ozone layer.
Yes.
That's something we know is a problem. We know that if we don't do something about it, we're going to have global warming and all the rest. But we don't know what's coming in 2012.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe nothing, maybe something. If it's something, we want to be prepared as we can. And I'm trying to get that point across to the people who are investing. They're investing in their own future.
Right.
They're investing in the future of the whole planet, actually. Because if you can be saved, and you know, it depends on how much damage is done to,
right,
the planet. Hopefully, it won't be very much.
Right.
We don't know that.
Well, you know,
I want to let you know that there is a DVD. You can see it on my, it's a header on my page, Zero Effect. And the DVD was done commercially by Brad Lockerman in Los Angeles,
yes,
in Hollywood, and it's a professional documentary of John Cyril's work. So
yes,
people should be aware of that.
I noticed that there's several links that people can go to, which is John Searle Story, and that's S-E-A-R-L is the last name, John S-E-A-R-L Story.com. They can also take a look at the CyrilEffect.com, John Searle Solutions.com, and ShallowCommand.com. Tell me about that one.
Swallow Command.
Swallow Command, excuse me.
Yeah, so it's Dan Searle has started a number of different pages for different reasons and to get different information out. Now, the original one is the Searle Effect. That's our page. My son actually has been the webmaster on that since the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
And it offers a lot of information, answers a lot of questions, and it gives out a lot of general information to the public.
Yes.
Some of the more specifics as far as engineers and scientists will find some of the specifics in the other websites.
Yes.
And then there's also the Wikipedia site that's been, we've had that updated, so it's fairly accurate now. And that tells a little bit about the John Searle story.
Right. Well, I'll tell you, David Sirita has recently viewed the DVD documentary on this, and he's a brilliant physicist, and he says that the work is just incredible. It's one of the most incredible stories, and a lot of the information is, just blew him away whenever it came to it. So it's a good watch, that's for sure.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's good. I'm glad to hear that. I haven't heard a lot of feedback yet, and it's good to hear.
Well, that's a big one for you. That's a big one for you, believe me. So, how is John right now? A lot of people are wondering, why is it that we don't have John himself on the program?
Well, that's right. Yeah. Well, one of the reasons is John's hearing is not too good.
Yes.
When we go and to business meetings or any meetings, I have to sit next to him with his good ear.
Yes.
So he can hear. But that's one of the reasons, not the only one. He's got some bad phlebitis in his legs that makes traveling by airplane very painful.
Oh, yes.
And dangerous, actually, for clotting. And then he's, the other reason is that he's in Scotland now. He was promised that, if you come to Scotland and you hire Scottish people and do it here, we'll subsidize you. We'll fund your work.
Right. So
he moved to Scotland and they didn't.
Oh, really? Just come on over to Scotland.
Yeah, so he's in Scotland. If you know anything about Scotland, it's cold, damp.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Not good for the joints.
They're nice people and all, but it's a cold, rainy atmosphere, I'll tell you.
It sure is.
So he's looking now to possibly to move back to England, maybe southern London, southern England.
Yes.
Where it's a little warmer.
Yes.
But that won't happen unless we get, somebody to move him. Well, the important thing is to know is that he is the inventor. He is still alive. He still has got a tremendous amount of information that he has yet to release.
Yes.
Even though he's written hundreds of pages, hundreds of pages on his books, he still hasn't released everything yet.
He, in my opinion, is kind of a living Tesla in a sense.
Yeah. I would compare him to Tesla, and I have a great awe for Tesla.
Yes. And something.
Yeah. He knows these things, and he can manipulate and use the squares in different ways, and we have to nurture that instead of just ignoring it.
Right.
I mean, people are waiting. I don't know what they're waiting for. Waiting for him to die. I mean.
With the state of affairs, with the economy, and just people looking for just every way possible to free themselves from bonded situations like another bill, this is really important in my opinion. I mean, his work in creating really honestly is very inspiring to a lot of the electro generators that are being developed out there. I believe so. I can't confirm it. It's just a feeling that I have. But I got to admit that it's what got me curious. You know, his work got me curious in electro or magnetic generators. Being free from that alone and having that freedom and saving that money is just worth it.
Oh, yeah, it would be a tremendous thing. Just to give you a peace of mind, in the independence, you're not in somebody else's control.
Yes.
All the time.
Yes.
And I just, you know, up until fairly recently, this technology was being dismissed offhand by all scientists in the mainstream.
Right.
They just say, oh, free energy, and they go, no, they're not, get out of here. But now there's so many people doing work in the same area.
Yes.
And having various degrees of success, that now it's accepted as far as, at least let's look at it.
Right.
And if I could just get, you know, I've got letters that I've written to three presidents and got some replies. And, I mean, I've done things that, you know, maybe are a stab in the dark, but you hope that maybe one of them will listen.
Sure.
And one will, or send somebody out or tell me to come out and explain it to them, and I will.
Yes.
And if we can get this built, it's going to be a phenomenal thing.
Yes.
If nothing happens in 2012, it still will clean up our atmosphere. It will help our healing system. It will be able to have spacecraft. It will truly be phenomenal.
Right. Yeah, we don't have to worry about Russia getting us up and down. One of the things that my producer had told me is that at one point you were on a radio program. You were talking about John's story.
Mm-hmm.
Radio host, the talk radio host, got a tremendous amount of fantastic feedback from that interview, and he wanted to have you back on again. But his higher-ups, the people who basically control the show, said no, didn't they?
That's right. That was George Maeda, and he said that the response they got was better than any other program they ever did, and by almost double.
Yes.
And the sponsors would not allow him to do a follow-up.
Really?
So somebody got to somebody.
That's odd, isn't it?
The sponsors, you'd think that they'd want, I mean, if you got a big listening audience.
Yes.
And it's all positive.
Yes.
You'd want to visually watch your commercial.
That's right.
But they said no.
They said no. That's really strange, yeah. Whenever it comes to corporate RAN and major sponsored-backed programs, you become a slave to those people, and you know,
right.
And then whomever passes down the call, I want to call it to nick something for whatever reason, you know, then it happens.
Well, this has been stopped so many times, and now maybe it's time for it to come out when at least. There are other ones coming out. Like, there was no hybrid cars.
Right.
The only ones that were out there were rentals, and then they took those and crushed them all.
Did you see the magnetic-engined motorcycle out of China? This thing completely runs off a magnetic engine. It has no electrical part. I take that back. It does have some electricity running through it.
Yeah.
But it takes no fuel whatsoever. There's no fuel cell. There's no anything like that. You just crank it up, and away you go, and this thing can go up to at least 50 miles an hour.
No, I haven't seen that.
I was quite impressed.
YouTube or what?
Yeah, there's one on YouTube, yes.
Oh, I'll take a look at it.
Yeah, and I was quite impressed by this. And so the power of magnetics, with magnetic technology, it's really going up there. And I think, I really do believe that John himself, I mean, he has so many different avenues that he can branch off with his technology right now,
oh, yeah,
to probably even fund the ultimate goal, that right now is a ripe time. So I think you're absolutely right. More word about this and more documentation and more spreading the info is absolutely key.
Yeah, I think that's the way to go, because now's the time. They waited around, sat around and waited for somebody to do it, and sit in their lap.
That's right.
And say, here's your you know, and her investors waiting for, you know, I can give her a full return of my money in a month. You know?
That's right.
But that didn't happen.
Yes.
A lot of work happened.
Yes.
And now it's time to cash in on that, because the people who are going to fund this work are also going to be the ones who can be the most benefited.
And I'll tell you what, there's some very devious people out there where they can just come to John and be like, well, tell me about this. How does it work? What do you got here?
Well, they've tried.
Yeah.
I've been offered quite a great deal of money to tell people how this works.
Yes, yes.
And they said, I'm sorry.
Well, you know what? I think you're doing the right thing. I think coming out now and talking about it, and I hope to talk to John himself one day about all of this, and the more info being spread, the better, and more people looking into it. It doesn't hurt either.
That might be good. That might be a good idea. I'll talk to John about that too, and then if he's agreeable, I'll pass on his number to you.
That'd be great. That'd be fantastic. Yeah. So, real quick again, where should people begin if they want to look deeper into this? Where would they go to start? And
I would go to serumeffect.com.
Okay, that's the best place to start, and from there, just work your way.
We've got an all access section, and that one you can go into the company store.
Yes.
And I've got all of the books, all of the lectures. The lectures from Tesla, the lectures from New Energy,
yes.
Lectures from the conference on future energy in Washington. All those are on CDs and are available. So,
fantastic.
So that would give them an idea of who John Searle is, what the device is, how it works, and when can they get one.
Right. Incredible story. John, thanks so much for being on the program. I know that you have had surgery recently, that you have some medical things, and hanging out with me for 3 hours to talk about this is a little difficult for you, but I really appreciate you doing it, I more than you know.
Well, that's great. I'm glad to do it.
You bet. Have a fantastic night. We'll talk to you soon, and Celine will follow up with you tomorrow.
Okay, great.
You have a good one.
Same to you.
Bye-bye.